Everyone, I am Dr. Tejavati Nagaraj. Today I will be discussing about the bisecting angle technique. I am Professor and Head Department of Oral Medicine and Radiology, Sri Rajiv Gandhi College of Dental Sciences, Bangalore. Coming to bisecting angle technique, it is one of the techniques for taking intraoral periapical radiographs. Basically, we have two techniques for taking intraoral periapical radiographs. What are intraoral periapical radiographs? Whenever you keep the film inside the oral cavity and take a radiograph, it is called as intraoral periapical radiograph. You should be able to see 3 to 4 millimeters of the periapical region. The whole coronal portion should be seen. Apart from that, even the periapical region, 3 to 4 millimeters of it should be seen. This we call it as intraoral periapical radiograph. Basically, we take intraoral periapical radiographs in all the clinics as well as in the hospitals for routine diagnostic purposes. So bisecting angle technique is one of the techniques for taking intraoral periapical radiograph. It was developed by Weston Price in 1904. Coming to bisecting angle technique, it works on a simple theorem. That is Sizansky's rule of isometry, which states that two triangles are equal when they share one side. Not only that, the corresponding sides and angles are also equal. In this diagram, you see the tooth, you see the central axis of the tooth. The central axis of the tooth and the receptor, they come to contact at one particular point. You have the imaginary bisector, which is bisecting that angle. And you have the central rays coming from the collimator or the collimated beam. So you have two triangles. Sizansky's rule of isometry states that two triangles are equal when they share one side. Not only that, the corresponding sides are also equal and the corresponding angles are also equal. This is it. The bisecting angle technique is based on the simple geometric theorem, Sizansky's rule of isometry, which states that two triangles are equal when they share one complete side and have two equal angles. So, which are the sides? The central axis of the tooth, the imaginary bisector, and the receptor. So, which are the two triangles? One side of the first triangle is the central axis of the tooth. The common side is the imaginary bisector, and the base is made of the central rays. And for your second triangle, you have one side by the imaginary bisector, the other side of the triangle is the receptor, and the third side is made up of the central rays. This is the simple geometric theorem on which we have the bisecting angle technique for taking intraoral periapical radiographs. The receptor must be placed close to the tooth under investigation as possible without being bent. At the point where the receptor contacts the tooth, the plane of the receptor and the long axis of the tooth form an angle. The dental radiographer must visualize a plane that divides in half or bisects the angle formed by the receptor and the long axis of the tooth. This plane is termed as imaginary bisector. The imaginary bisector creates two equal angles and provides a common side for the two imaginary equal triangles. The dental radiographer must then direct the central ray of the X-ray beam perpendicular to the imaginary bisector. The central ray is directed at an angle of 90 degrees to the imaginary bisector. Two imaginary triangles that result are right angle and are congruent. The hypotenuse of one imaginary triangle is represented by the long axis of the tooth. The other hypotenuse is represented by the plane of the receptor. That's a bisecting angle technique. The upper arch and the lower arch teeth are shown there. Where the film has to be placed, the film placement. The film should be placed as close as possible to the teeth. Resting in the palate if it's maxillary, or resting in the floor of the mouth if it is mandibular. There are certain angulations to be followed. You have vertical angulation and horizontal also. I'm talking about the vertical angulation. angulation guidelines for bisecting angle projections. For all the maxillary teeth, it's positive or plus angulation, and for mandibular teeth is minus or negative angulation. The angulations would have been graded or shown on the collimator. You're supposed to fix this angulation and take the radiographs. For maxillary central and lateral incisors, it is plus 40 degrees. For maxillary canines, it is plus 45 degrees. For maxillary premolars, it is plus 30 degrees. And for maxillary molars, it is plus 20 degrees. Coming to mandibular teeth, for mandibular central and lateral incisors, it is minus 15 degrees. For mandibular canines, it is minus 20 degrees. For mandibular premolars, it is minus 10 degrees. And for mandibular molars, it is minus 5 degrees. These are the angulations which you will have to follow while taking bisecting angle technique. This is a vertical angulation. Next, we have the head position, film placement, vertical angulation, horizontal angulation, the point of entry of the central ray. Coming to the head position of the client positioning, the mid sagittal plane has to be perpendicular to the floor and the occlusal plane has to be parallel to the floor. Sit the patient on the dental chair. The back has to be stabilized with the backrest. The head has to be stabilized with the headrest. Then there are certain imaginary lines which you'll have to take into consideration. Whenever you are taking the radiographs, intraoral periapical radiographs of maxillary teeth using bisecting angle technique, always check for the alar tragal line. It's an imaginary line drawn from the ala of the nose to the tragus of the ear. Whenever you are taking the radiographs of maxillary teeth, see that the alar tragal line is parallel to the floor. And whenever you are taking mandibular teeth, see that the line drawn from the angle of the mouth to the tragus of the ear has to be parallel to the floor. I repeat it again. Whenever you are taking maxillary radiographs, see that the alar tragal line, that is a line drawn from the ala of the nose to the tragus of the ear, has to be parallel to the floor. Whenever you are taking the mandibular radiographs, see that the line drawn from the angle of the mouth to the tragus has to be parallel to the floor. These are all the imaginary lines. And again, whenever you are taking maxillary premolar radiographs, see that maxillary premolars, a line drawn from the pupil of the eye downwards where it crosses the alar tragal line, the central ray has to point there. Whenever you are taking the maxillary posterior molar radiographs, a line drawn from the lateral canthus of the eye downwards where it crosses the alar tragal line. Alar tragal line is imaginary, line drawn from the angle of the mouth to the tragus of the ear is again imaginary. A line drawn from the pupil of the eye downwards, these are all imaginary lines for us to position the collimator. Film placement. I told you the film should be placed behind the teeth of interest. Receptor stabilization. We have the bite blocks for holding the film, or you can always ask the patient to hold the film with the bulb of the index finger or with the thumb. We have Rin Bite, Dense Ply, Rin Corp, Elgin, Stable Bite Block, Easy Grip Receptor Holder, Snap Ring. Usually, most of the time we use the snap ring, which is easier to operate. Otherwise, you can always ask the patient to hold the film or stabilize the film with the bulb of the index finger. Buys with collimators are recommended. Aiming rings are also there, that we use it for the parallel cone technique. When I discuss the parallel cone technique, I'll be telling you. Aiming rings are included that aid in the alignment of position indicating device. Collimators significantly reduce the amount of patient's exposure to radiation. This is the angulations for the maxillary radiographs. The first one is anterior maxillary for the central and lateral incisors. The central rays will pass through the tip of the nose. The angulation given is plus 40 degrees and the radiograph which you are seeing is central maxillary, central and lateral incisors. Next is for maxillary canines. Angulation given is plus 45 degrees and you are able to see the maxillary lateral incisor with maxillary canine. Third one is, it's for the maxillary premolars. I told you, these are all imaginary lines. A line drawn from the pupil of the eye downwards where it crosses the allotrigal line. Angulation is plus 30 degrees and the radiograph which you see there is maxillary premolars. And coming to maxillary molars, angulation is plus 40 degrees. The central ray will enter the patient's face through the lateral canthus of the eye. You are able to see the maxillary molars. Maxillary central and lateral incisors, the central rays pass through the tip of the nose. For maxillary lateral incisor, it passes through the aisle of the nose. For maxillary canines, it passes through the canine eminence. And for maxillary premolar, the central rays will pass through a line drawn from the pupil of the eye downwards where it crosses the allotrigal line. And for maxillary molars, it enters the patient's face through the lateral canthus of the eye. Maxillary central and lateral incisors plus 40 degrees. Maxillary canines plus 45 degrees. Maxillary premolars plus 30 degrees. And maxillary molars plus 20 degrees. Coming to the mandibular radiographs. Mandibular central and lateral incisors, the central rays will pass through the symphysis. Angulation is minus 15 degrees. For mandibular canine, angulation is minus 20 degrees. The central rays will pass through the canine eminence. For mandibular premolars, the angulation is minus 10 degrees. The central rays will pass through the line drawn from the pupil of the eye downwards where it crosses a line joining angle of the mouth to the tragus of the ear. And for mandibular molars, it is minus 5 degrees. The central rays will pass through the line drawn from the lateral canthus of the eye downwards where it crosses a line joining angle of the mouth to the tragus of the ear. Mandibular central and lateral incisors, angulation is minus 15 degrees. For mandibular canines, it is minus 20 degrees. For mandibular premolars, it is minus 10 degrees. And for mandibular molars, it is minus 5 degrees. Here, the phylum is held with the bite block. It is stabilized with the bite block. Coming to the vertical angulation. Whenever there is excessive vertical angulation, it will result in foreshortening. And whenever there is deficient vertical angulation, it results in elongation. Elongation is also a faulty radiograph and foreshortening is also faulty radiograph. That's why always stick on to vertical angulation. Coming to the horizontal angulation, the X-rays have to be perpendicular to the phylum and the object. In case there is change in the horizontal angulation, it causes overlapping of the images. Again, overlapping of the images is a faulty radiograph. The central rays have to be perpendicular to the object and the phylum. Horizontal angulation and vertical angulations. This is the position of the maxillary central incisor. The first picture A, the patient is holding the phylum or stabilizing the phylum with the bulb of the index thumb finger. Whereas the second one, it's held by the bite block. And the central rays enter through the tip of the nose. For maxillary canines, the patient is stabilizing or holding the phylum with the bulb of the index finger. Second, the X-ray phylum is stabilized with the bite block. The central rays are entering the patient's face through the canine eminence. Here, the maxillary premolars. Figure A, the patient is holding the phylum with the bulb of the index finger, stabilizing the phylum with the bulb of the index finger. Second, it is held by the bite block. The central rays are entering the patient's face through a line drawn from the pupil of the eye downwards where it crosses the allotrigal line. For maxillary premolars. Maxillary molars. The patient is stabilizing the phylum with the bulb of the index finger. The central rays are entering the patient's face through the lateral canthus of the eye. For maxillary molars. Mandibular, central and lateral incisors. The central rays are entering the patient's face through the symphysis. Figure A, the patient is holding the phylum with the bulb of the index finger. Second, with the bite block. Mandibular, central and lateral incisors. For mandibular canine, figure 8, the patient is stabilizing the film with the bulb of the index finger. This is for the mandibular canine, intraoral periapical radiograph. Mandibular premolars, again, the patient is stabilizing the film with the bulb of the index finger. And just remember, all the centering points for mandibular teeth are located 1 to 2 centimeters above the lower border of the mandible. All the centering points lie above 1 to 2 centimeters above the lower border of the mandible. Mandibular molars, again, figure 8, the patient is stabilizing the film with the bulb of the index finger. And again, the central rays are entering perpendicular to the film and the object. This is a line drawn from the lateral canthus of the eye downwards, where it crosses a line joining angle of the mouth to the tragus of the ear. Coming to the advantages of bisecting angle technique, there is no film holder required. Better technique when anatomical variations hinder parallel technique. Decreased exposure time. Positioning of the film is relatively more comfortable to the patient in all areas of the mouth. Because we don't use the film holders, it's very easy to position the film in the oral cavity. Disadvantages, there could be image distortion, there could be angulation problem, that is vertical angulation can be increased or decreased, which causes foreshortening and elongation, or there could be change in the horizontal angulation, which causes overlapping of images, which are both faulty in nature, unnecessary exposure. Shadow of the zygomatic bone is frequently seen over the apex of the maxillary molars, difficulty in angulation, and not reproducible. Positioning difficulties are mandibular third molar. To place the film, it's slightly difficult. There could be gagging for the patient. Endodontics. When patient comes with reamers and filed with a rubber dam, it will be difficult to place the intraoral periapical film. Edentulous ridges, difficult to hold the film, and pediatric children, it's difficult to take. This is it, edentulous patients, pediatric patients, third molar, and endodontically treating teeth. Thank you.